also nothing. You are nothing. You hear me? Do not tell them anything. Do not tell them anything. I wasn't here. I was just having some fun, all right? I'm just gonna leave.
You know what? I was just here for this thing. I've been looking for it. I don't know why did I carry all those boxes. But you heard nothing, you saw nothing. I was just here for this thing, so do not tell them anything. Now I'll see you guys in the video.
Hello and welcome guys, my name is Steve and welcome to my channel where I share my engineering experience with you. So first of all, super sorry that this video wasn't published on Friday. This was supposed to be a 5-minute Friday, but it's gonna be a longer video instead. So because a lot of you have been asking for this topic, today we are doing Go modules in Go. So before we begin throwing in examples and code, let me go ahead and give you a quick overview of what we're gonna do in this video. So number one on the list, we're gonna create a small project using Go modules. Number two on the list, we're gonna explore some of the Go mod commands. Number three of the list, we're gonna explore Go get commands and how exactly they work with Go modules. Number four, we're gonna explore semantic import versioning and what exactly that is in Go. Number five on the list, we're gonna explore the ins and outs of Go modules. And finally, number six on the list, we're gonna migrate a small project from Dev Package Manager to Go modules. So without further ado, guys, let's dive right in. All right, so first things first, let's go ahead and create a small project using Go modules. But in order to create a small project using Go modules, we actually need two files. We need go.mod and go.sum. So let's jump into the terminal and generate these two files. So inside the terminal, I'm gonna go and cd into desktop and then make a directory over there called Go modules, for example. And then let's cd into Go modules. And let's run a simple command which is gonna initialize this project using Go modules. So I'm gonna say go mod init. I'm gonna give it a name, for example, github.com/stevehook, which is my username, /go-modules. So I named the module this way in order for it to be compatible with older tools, with older versions of Go which do not support Go modules. So as you can tell, we successfully generated the project using Go modules. So if you do an ls, as you can see, we have this file called go.mod. So if you do cut go.mod, as you can see, we have a couple of things generated over there. Next, let's go ahead and generate go.sum file. But in order for us to generate the go.sum file, we have to add a couple of dependencies to our project. So I'm gonna say go get github.com/julianschmidt/http router. As you can see, we successfully downloaded Julian Schmidt HTTP router. Next, let's go ahead and add in another dependency. So I'm gonna say go get go.uber.org/zap. So this is another dependency when it comes to logging things out. So to prove that the go.sum file was generated, let's do an ls. So as you can see, go.sum was generated successfully. If you do cut go.sum, as you can see, we have a bunch of things generated over there as well. Now keep in mind, the go.sum file is a generated file and you don't have to edit or modify this file. Next, let's jump into the text editor and explore the go.mod and go.sum files which got generated. So I opened the project inside Visual Studio Code, and as you can see, we have go.mod and go.sum files generated. So let's go ahead and open up go.mod and have a look at what exactly got generated for us. So if you open up go.mod file, as you can see, we have a couple of things generated over here. On the first line, we have the module declaration, which is nothing else but the module name which we gave when we said go mod in it. Then we have the Go version or the Go engine, which in my case is 1.14, which is the latest version of Go at the moment. But if you have something like 1.13, it should work totally fine. And lastly, we have the require statement or the require group, which is nothing else but the dependencies which we're gonna use. And this is the most important thing in this file, and this is what you're mostly gonna edit. So as you can see here, we have these two dependencies which we added. We have github.com/julianschmidt-http-router, and we have the go-uber.org/zap-logger. And these indirect comments basically indicate that we're not using these dependencies inside our project. So basically, don't worry about that too much. We're gonna fix that. We're gonna get rid of these indirect comments later on. Now let's go and have a look at the go.sum file. So if you open up go.sum file, as you can see, we have a bunch of dependencies here, dependencies which we did not indicate when we said go get. And you are right, these are not the dependencies which we downloaded. These are the dependencies which our dependencies for our project need in order to work properly. So basically, this is the dependency graph, this is the transitive dependencies, or in other words, the dependencies which our dependencies need in order to work properly. So to make it simpler for you, I called go.mod the ingredients and go.sum the instructions on how to use these ingredients. All right, so to actually get rid of those indirect comments, all you have to do is to actually make use of these dependencies which we downloaded by using go get. So all you have to do is open up your text editor and create a file called main.go. So let's say main.go. Inside main.go, let's actually make this bigger. Let's say package main, and let's say func main, and let's put out some code over here. So for the sake of simplicity, I'm just gonna go ahead and create a small HTTP router using Julian Schmidt HTTP router, which we downloaded. So I'm gonna say router equals HTTP router.new, and then I'm gonna say router.get. Let's pass in a path and then some controller, which doesn't exist yet. Then let's say http.listen and serve. And let's pass in a small HTTP port and then the router. Let's also wrap this inside log.fatal just to make sure we actually log everything out in case we have some error. And let's also actually create this function. As you can see, we get an error because we do not have this function. So let's go ahead and say func index. It's going to receive three arguments. First one is going to be http.responseWriter. Second one is going to be, as usual, pointer to HTTP request. And the third one is going to be a custom one specific to Julian Schmidt router, HTTP router.ramps. And there you have it. So to keep it simple as well, we're just going to log out something using Zap Logger, which we downloaded as well. So I'm going to say logger and an error equals to zap.new production. And then let's say logger.info, and I'm just gonna print something like successfully performed HTTP request. Now let's go ahead and run this program and make sure it actually works. So if you open up your terminal and you cd into the project, all you have to do is actually say go run main.go. Boom, the program is actually running, the server is up and running. Now let's go ahead and test the server. All you have to do is actually say curl localhost and then 8080 because that is what we allocated. If you open up the first tab, as you can see, we have this small, beautiful JSON log, which says successfully performed HTTP request, which is what we logged out in that index function. However, the question remains the same. How do we get rid of those indirect comments? Well, it's very simple. All you have to do is say go mod tidy, and that's gonna do it. If we print out the contents of go.mod file, you will see that those comments are gone. So let's say cat go.mod, and as you can see, those comments are gone. However, go mod tidy also makes sure to actually get rid of those dependencies inside the go mod file in case we are not referencing them inside the project, or it makes sure to add them in case we are referencing them inside the project. So let me go ahead and show you an example to prove you that. So let's open up go.mod inside the text editor. So if you open up go.mod, as you can see, we have these dependencies over here. Let me go ahead and actually remove these dependencies. So if you remove these dependencies, save up this file and open up a terminal and say go mod tidy, as you can see, those dependencies will reappear again inside go.mod file. Now the same happens if we add in a dependency which is not needed, which is not used inside the project. So let's open up a new terminal window and add a dependency which we're not using. So let's say go get, and let's add this dependency rsc.io/quote. As you can see, we added this dependency successfully. It says indirect because we're not using this dependency. And now let's go ahead and run go mod tidy. But before we do that, let's go ahead and run another go mod command to actually show you why do we need this dependency if we need it and why do we not need it. So we're gonna run go mod y, paste this line. And as you can see, it says main module does not need this package. However, when you run go mod tidy, it's just simply gonna get rid of it. All right, so next let's talk about go get variations. What are the different variations when it comes to go get, specifically when we're using go modules? So one thing to keep in mind when using go get is the fact that if you have go modules enabled, meaning you have a go mod file, is the fact that when you use go get, it's gonna try to add that dependency inside the file, inside the go mod file, if you don't have it, and it's gonna try to update it if you already have it inside go mod file. Next, I wanna talk about the latest tag or the latest version when it comes to using go get. Let's jump into the terminal and give you a simple example of that. So for example, if you run go get, and let's say you want this package, Julian Schmidt HTTP router, this one is absolutely exactly the same as saying at latest or saying at version 1.3. So whether you use go modules or not, the best way is just not provide any version at all because these are exactly the same. And this is the case when you just try to add a dependency, not update a dependency. Next way of using go get is by specifically providing a version, as you saw earlier. So you should run go get, provide in the package, say at, type in the V is required absolutely, and then provide in a version, for example, 1.2. As you can see, we successfully downloaded version 1.2 of this module. Next way of using go-get is by providing a specific commit, a specific git commit or git hash. That is also known as a pseudo version. So if you get back to our module Julian Schmidt HTTP router, all you have to do is simply replace the version with this hash. So you say at and you provide in the hash, and it's gonna download the changes from that commit from that point in time. Another thing I want to talk about is something which is Go related, and that is semantic import versioning. What the heck is that, and how exactly is that reflected in Go? So when you download a package using Go get, for example, Go get, and you provide an rsc.io/code, and that package has multiple versions, multiple major versions, and that major version is not 0 or 1. You have to be a little more specific than that. So let's say you run go get rsc.io/quote. Let's see what exactly gets downloaded. As you can see, version 1.5.2 gets downloaded. But the question is that the latest version? Well, let's check it out on GitHub. So if you go on github.com/rsc/quote, as you can see, we have a bunch of versions over there. So let's go ahead and check out the releases tab. As you can see, the latest version is not 1.5.2, but it's version 3.1.0. So what exactly is happening? Well, that brings me to the next topic, which is semantic import versioning. So we tried to download this package called quote. However, the latest version was version 3.1.0, but it did download the version 1.5. So what exactly happened behind the scenes? Why didn't it download the latest version? Because that's what we want, right? Well, that is related to something called semantic import versioning when it comes to Go and when it comes to Go modules and how versioning is done in Go. But before we talk about semantic import versioning, let's see what's gonna happen if we try to download the latest version, which is version 3.1.0. So inside the terminal, I'm gonna say go get same package, and this time we're gonna say at version 3.1.0, because that is the latest version, right? As you can see, it's not gonna work. It's gonna give you a simple error, which is gonna say it doesn't work. It's gonna say module contains a Go mode file, so major version must be compatible, should be v0 or v1, not v3. What exactly that means and how is that related to our problem, you may ask yourself, right? So when it comes to Go modules and how versioning is done, you have three versions mainly. You have the version 0, which means when you try to download a package or a library which has the version 0, it means anytime in the future if that library updates or that package updates, it may bring breaking changes, and that is something which is known, that is something which the clients or the developers are supposed to be aware of. Then you have another version, which is major version 1, which basically means that package or library you try to download is super stable, which means it's gonna introduce small fixes, bug fixes, or small features. And that is nothing bad, that is nothing which is gonna break the package or the library you're trying to use. And then you have major version 2+, which means any major version which goes above version 1 is gonna have to be handled a little bit different. You're gonna have to be explicit about it when you try to download it, which means you're gonna have to adjust the path, and you're also gonna have to be explicit about it when you try to use it inside the import path. So let's see inside the terminal how exactly are you supposed to download this major version 3, which is the latest version at the moment. So to fix this, we're gonna slightly adjust the URL, and that's gonna do it. So we have the same go get, and this time we're gonna say /v3, and that's gonna do it. That's gonna download the major version 3. It is as simple as that, as simple as just modifying the URL, and that is how Go treats major versions 2+, major versions which go above version 1. So to make use of this package which we just downloaded, which makes use of major version 3, all we have to do is slightly adjust this index function. So let's say logger.info, and let's provide in quote v3, which is gonna be the name import.hello v3. And let's import this one. Let's say quote v3, and let's provide in the import path. And the import path is going to change as well, because we're using major version above 1. We're using major version 3. So it's going to be something like rsc.io/quote/v3, and we have to provide in v3 inside the path. And let's go ahead and run this example to see if that works. So let's say go run main.go, and as you can see, this one works. So if you go ahead and open up a new tab and you say curl localhost 8080, as you can see, nothing happened, but inside the first tab says hello world, which is the message we actually printed inside that logger. All right, next let's talk about a couple of ways to fetch all the dependencies once you have a fresh clone of the project, once you have a fresh clone, which supposedly means that you don't have those packages on your local machine. So if you have a fresh copy or a fresh clone of your project and you don't have those packages installed on your local machine, the first thing you can do is run a simple command which is gonna parse your source code, and based on your source code and on the references of the packages you have, it's gonna download all the packages which you have referenced inside the code. So the command we're talking about is go get dot slash dot dot dot. That's gonna do exactly what I was saying. And this is available whether you're using Go modules or not. Now, another way to fetch all of your dependencies once you have a fresh copy or a fresh clone of your project is by simply running Go run, Go build, or Go test. Now, to simulate that, let's go ahead and first clean up our cache, clean up our download cache to actually make sure we don't have any packages on local machine and to actually make sure the packages get downloaded whenever we say Go run, Go build, or Go test. So I'm gonna clean my download cache by saying Go clean minus cache minus mod cache minus I minus R, and that's gonna clean the local cache. That's gonna clean the download cache of all the modules you have downloaded locally. And now let's simply run Go build. So Go build, as you can see, it's gonna go ahead and download all the packages which you have referenced inside the go.mod file, and that's gonna work. Next, let's talk about a special feature of Go modules, and that is being compatible with the vendor directory. Now, if you don't know what vendor directory is and the vendor directory feature, make sure to check out this video. So to generate a vendor directory of all the dependencies compatible with older versions of Go, with tools that use older versions of Go and do not have Go module support, it's very simple. All you have to do is say Go mod vendor, and that's gonna do it. If you do NLS, as you can see, we have the vendor directory available now. Another useful feature when it comes to fetching other third-party packages right from the terminal is to list all the versions available so that you know which versions you want to download. Now, a very simple command to fetch all the versions available for a specific package is go list. So all you have to do is run go list minus m minus versions and provide in the package. So as you can see, we get an error that we cannot do this while having this vendor directory. So let's go ahead and say rm minus rf vendor, and let's run this command again. As you can see, this displays the available list of versions, so it's a pretty neat feature. So make sure to use this feature whenever you try to download a third-party package or library, but you don't know which versions you want to use. And also keep in mind, if you have versions above major version 1, you'll have to adjust the path when you run go get, you'll have to adjust the import path inside your project and all that stuff, which I showed you before. Now, another way of fetching all of your dependencies which your project needs in order to run without having to consult your code, just as go get does, is simply to run another go mod command. So all you have to do is open up the terminal, cd into your project, and run go mod download. And that's basically going to download every dependency which is linked inside the go.mod file. That's not going to consult the source code, just as go get dot slash dot 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 does. Now let's have a look at some of the internals of go modules and where exactly things get downloaded inside go path. So if you open up go path directory, you already know that it has the bin directory, the pkj directory, and the source directory. So if you open up the pkj directory, as you can see, we have a bunch of directories over here, but what I want you to focus on is this mod directory. So this mod directory is basically where everything related to go modules is stored. Basically every version of package we download is stored here. So if you open up the mod directory, as you can see, we have a bunch of other directories stored here. So as you can see, inside this mod directory, everything looks like go path slash source. You have hosts, you have users inside the host, and inside each users you have packages, inside each package you have the contents, and so on and so forth. What I want you to pay attention inside this mod directory also is the cache directory. So inside the cache directory, as you can see, we have download, and inside download we have the same structure as go path. So we have github.com, we have the users, Julian Schmidt, for example, HTTP router, and at V. And as you can see here, we have some sort of cache. So whenever we download this package over and over again, it's gonna use the cache as opposed to using the network. So that is pretty much it on the ins and outs of Go modules, where things get downloaded. So feel free to explore this on your own and play around. All right, so next we're talking about two environment variables when it comes to Go, when it comes to using Go modules and downloading third-party packages. So we are talking about Go proxy and Go sumdb. What are these variables and how exactly they help us when it comes to downloading these packages? So first off, let's have a look at Go proxy and what exactly that is. So if you open up a terminal and you type in go env, let's do a pipe rep, and you look for go proxy, you'll see something like this: proxy.golang.work, direct. What exactly that means? Well, that means whenever you're trying to download a third-party package, it's gonna look it up on proxy.golang.work. If it doesn't find it there, it's gonna try to use the network, which basically means direct. So it's gonna try to look it up on GitHub and download it from GitHub and then save it in the database, save it in the proxy database. So that is a pretty useful feature because, for example, if the VCS or if GitHub, for example, dies, it's gonna try to download the package from this proxy, and we're still gonna have access to the package even if GitHub is down, for example. Now, what if the package you wanna download is compromised or the author pushed some malicious code? Well, that's why we have GoSumDB. Basically, GoSumDB is a database of checksums. So basically, if we downloaded something we did not want, it's gonna check against that checksum database, and it's gonna see if that matches the checksum, it means we downloaded what we wanted. If that doesn't match the checksum, it means we downloaded some malicious code, some code which was modified. So let's open up the terminal and look up the GoSumDB environment variable. So let's say go env pipe grep GoSumDB. As you can see, GoSumDB defaults to sum.golang.work. So basically, whenever you try to download a package, it's gonna look it up on this checksum to check if we actually downloaded what we wanted to download, because we might download something which is malicious, which was modified, which was compromised. So there you have it on GoProxy and GoSumDB, guys. I'm gonna make sure to put down some links in the description below of this video, so make sure to check them out and make sure to check out more information about GoProxy and GoSumDB. All right, so lastly, I wanna show you a small example of how to migrate a project, a simple project, which is basically the same project using GoDeb or Deb Package Manager to Go Modules. So let me go ahead and open up the terminal and print out the contents of this directory. So if I do an ls, as you can see, we have gopkj.log, gopkj.toml, and main.go. So if we print out the contents of main.go, as you can see, we have the same example using Julian Schmidt HTTP router and gouber.org/zap-packages. So if we print out the contents of gopkj.toml, as you can see, we have the same exact dependencies. So let's say cat gopkj.toml, and as you can see, we have the exact same dependencies. We have Julian Schmidt HTTP router, and we have gouber.org/zap. So to migrate this project to using Go modules, it's actually very easy and simple. All you have to do is run go mod init. So let's say go mod init, and let's give it a name. Let's say github.com/stevehook/go-modules, for example. As you can see, it's trying to copy everything from gopkj.toml and from gopkj.log into go-mod. So it's gonna generate the go.mod file using gopkj.log and gopkj.toml. So Go is capable of generating go.mod file from multiple recipes, including gopkj.log, including Glide and different other package managers. I'm gonna link all the supported recipes in the video description below. So if you do an ls, as you can see, we have generated this go.mod file. So let's go ahead and print its contents out. So let's say cat go.mod. As you can see, it successfully generated the go.mod file. It successfully added some dependencies. However, it added more dependencies than we actually need. As you can see here, it added atomic, it added multi-error, and we don't need these dependencies. So what do we do when we don't need some dependencies and we don't even use them? Well, it's very simple. You're right, we're using go mod tidy. So let's say go mod tidy, and as you can see, it's gonna try to clear this out. And if you do cat go.mod again, as you can see, it cleared out the package, and now we only have what we're using inside our project. So this is how simple it is to migrate a project to Go modules. So make sure to play around and make sure to tweak this example. Alright guys, that is it for this super long video. Make sure to hit that like button if you like this video and you found it useful, and make sure to subscribe if you aren't already. And without further ado, guys, make sure to check out the resources section below, where I linked everything that I used in this video, the resources, the source code, and everything is there. And now, if you'll excuse me, guys, I have some business to solve. So stay tuned, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.